absolutely everything. Now, I know that's probably not what you meant when you asked me that. You probably meant what's the definition of it. But for me, trying to achieve that thing I remember saying so many times, if I could only have clarity of mind, that was always my thing, is to be clear in your mind. That clarity gives you happiness. And when you're happy, anything is achievable. Your day feels good. And you know, I never look at being in the public eye as a pressure. I've always found it a privilege. I think in the early days when I first started out, it went a little bit to my head and probably led to how me having a really horrific breakdown was probably because I took it all a bit too seriously. I think once you've been what they call a breakthrough, rather than a breakdown, because you do come through it, you can come through it, you realise how lucky you are. And I've got the best job in the world. I pinch myself all the time and go, oh my gosh, like people would dream to do the kind of things that I get to do. But I've only appreciated it now. I didn't really realise it back then. Yeah, I remember when I first had my first panic attack, which was horrific. And panic attacks in general usually last about 20 minutes, the actual attack, for you to sort of come out of it and realise. And at the time, you think you're going to die. There is nothing anybody could tell you that is going to make you understand that you're not going to die from this. It's just a fear, right? And I used to be really, I didn't know who to talk to. Couldn't talk to my mum and dad because they were so old school in the way they thought that they would just be like, go and get yourself a drink and you'll be fine. You know, they didn't understand. So I was too scared to tell them. And I was really scared until I found that I had to talk to somebody who specialised in this for me to be able to get it out of my system. Once I started to understand what the problem was, and the panic attacks were so regular every day for years, I started to want to talk about it because it's the only way I could feel better. And so the embarrassment turned to more, I've got to talk about this or I'm going to go mad, you know? It was the best thing I ever did. Right, I really want to be clear about this. When it comes to therapy, some people will disagree with what I'm going to say here. For me, both medication and therapy helped, and I'll explain why. Because medication doesn't solve the problem. What medication does is it puts you in a frame of mind to be able to deal with the problem. So if you just took the medication, which I've done before, I felt great all of a sudden. I felt back to normal, didn't think I needed therapy. Problem is that all you've done is you've swept the problem under the carpet, because the minute you stop that medication, because you're like, I don't need this now, it comes back with a vengeance. So the next time I went on medication, I decided I'm gonna go and get therapy. I was feeling good. So I didn't understand, you know, you can't really understand why you need the therapy, but you're in the right frame of mind to deal with the problem. Once you get the therapy to deal with what the issue actually is and you understand the issue, all of a sudden you start to solve the problem. I did see a therapist for a long time. Then I stopped seeing the therapist, carried on the medication. Then I thought, I don't need the medication. Came off the medication. I was so happy that after 10 years, I was able to stop medication. Then I lost my brother. The problem is that it came back with a vengeance. But what I didn't realize, silly me, was all I was doing was grieving. I wasn't having anxiety, panic attacks and depression. I was grieving. It's a natural process. But because I'd been through that before and the same fears were there, I presumed it was depression. So I went back on the medication because it came back with a vengeance. Then slowly I realized that it was just grieving and I needed to get through it naturally. And slowly, slowly, I went back to a therapist who helped me with grieving. Slowly, slowly, I came off everything. Now, I'm not stupid. I know that I could be more susceptible to falling back into this at any time. I also know that I might one day have to go back on medication or go and see a therapist, but I don't mind. There are people who have to take insulin every day. There are people that have to take asthma. They have to carry their asthma thing with them. You've got to make your life right. It's only there for a short period of time. So whatever it is you have to do, Don't be scared about it. Something a therapist said to me, I will never forget this. He said, if you saw someone, an elderly lady with a bad hip, she's trying to cross the road and she's carrying her bags, would you not go up and help her? Yeah. Now imagine that same lady is struggling in her mind. You can't see it. So you naturally are not going to want to go and help this person because you don't think there's anything wrong. The mental pain can be a lot worse than a physical pain. I've experienced both. So I can tell you that mental pain is terrible. It's so hard to deal with. And I really think it's important, especially with this campaign, especially now in this generation where Instagram and filters and shows that are showing perfection, so to speak, you know, what is classed as perfection in image, more than ever, depression is hitting schools, it's hitting people at a much younger age, anxiety. That's why they need to have that support system that we didn't have as kids. I think it's an incredible idea. That is why I'm supporting the Where's Your Head At campaign, to get a mental health first aider in every college and workplace.